another place in the heart. So don't curse out the light while you learn from the dark. Oh, life belongs when death sets us free. Feels like a blessing falling on me. I choose to abide.
cause you're there too. I won't be formed by feelings. I hold fast to what is true. If the cross brings transformation, then I'll be crucified with you. Cause death is just a doorway into resurrection life. And if I join you in your suffering, then I'll join.
Welcome. It's good to see everybody who's chosen to join us. Thank you for coming this morning and choosing to worship our Lord and our Savior. If you're a first-time guest, we'd like to extend an especially warm welcome to you. I think you will find us to be a warm and genuine crowd. Thank you for coming. My name is Carl. I'm one of the lay leaders here. If you're a first-timer or if you're relatively new and have any questions about Harvest, I would love to meet you after the service. I'll be outside at a table. More than willing to answer your questions. For everybody, pull out your phone. We would ask that you guys would click on the Connect card in the Church Center app. It's a new app if you haven't downloaded it. There's a QR code on the back of one of the chairs in front of you. And if you're still having trouble, just look around and grab your local fifth grader. He will help you download that app. And then you might want to change your password after that. Some of you guys might not know, for the first 2 weeks of July, the leadership gives the staff 2 weeks of Sabbath rest. They deserve it for the work that they do throughout the ministry year, and so the staff is off. We're in the middle of that right now. This is the middle weekend. The staff will be gone through next Friday, July 12th. We pray that this time is going to be refreshing for them. If you have a need during this time, please reach out. The elders would love to take care of any needs that you have. Let's pray for the morning. God, we just thank you for the time that you've allowed us to gather. Time that you give us, God, not because of who we are, but because of who you are and your love for us and your desire for us to live in a way that honors and glorifies you. God, I ask that you would use this time that you would help us to focus our hearts on you. I ask that you would give this couple of weeks rest to the staff, God, that you would recharge their batteries, that you would let them to rest, to relax, to take a moment for themselves and to refocus their energy so that they, when they come back, they can be truly focused on doing your work. God, we thank you. Thank you for letting us have a relationship with you, for loving us the way you do. And we ask all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Why don't we all stand and get ready to worship?
Oh, we shout out your praise. Yes, mercy never fails me. In all my days, I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Choose the praise. We will choose the praise. encourage, as we sing this next song, I just want to encourage you and invite you to remember the Lord's goodness and faithfulness and provision in your life. But if you're here this morning, maybe you're in a season of need or in a season of want, would you sing this song out in faith, knowing that there is a God who loves you and cares for you, and He can help you persevere and press on and provide. He can provide for you the things that you need to get through this season. So let's sing this out in faith.
Miracle worker, promise keeping.
Special offering for a need that we've identified outside the ministries of this church. And the July special offering is going to be for back to school needs that we've seen. Some of it will go to church families that are in need. Some of it will go to families that we've seen come through the Hope Center. And some will even go to local schools as they've identified families that need. There's ways to give on screen, and whether you give to the normal obviously we have ongoing expenses, the regular general fund, or whether you'd like to give to the special offering in July, there are some methods to give. There will also be people next to the doors as you give. For the special offering, we will only be collecting that through tonight at midnight. So if you want to participate in that, know that there's a deadline. Let's commit these things to God in prayer. God, you give us the opportunity to partner with you in touching lives. And God, as we give these gifts to you, I ask that you would, in a way that only you could do, take these earthly funds and use them to reap heavenly rewards. God, I ask that hearts would be touched, that lives would be changed, and that souls would be drawn close to you because of the ministries and the outreach that we are able to participate through your goodness to us. God, help us to have grateful hearts and to realize everything we have comes from you. God, thank you for the way that you have blessed us. And we ask all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Before you guys take a seat, do me a favor. Look around, find somebody that you have not come to church with and tell them you love their July 4th sunburn.
Works better with a mic when I turn it on. Hey, good morning, everybody. Good to see you. I just heard the craziest thing during the announcements. The staff is off for the next, like, what? Why am I always the last to know these things, right? No, I knew it, actually. Actually, the way it worked out, we had intended to have a guest come this weekend, and they couldn't do it. Recently had to change their plans, and actually, if I'm honest, I kind of wanted to have next weekend off, not this weekend off. I'm like, can I preach? And I'm like, yeah. So here we are. But if I've not met you yet, my name is Dave Learned. I'm one of the pastors. I serve in our care ministry and a part of our lead team with staff. And it's just really a joy to be able to open God's Word together today. It's us here in Rolling Meadows. It's also our friends in Elgin and Crystal Lake and Aurora and the North Shore. So how's it going, guys? Wish your pastors would work. Then you wouldn't have to listen to me. But anyway, I'll probably hear about that. So, no, it's really good to be together today. Question, how many of you ate something prepared on a grill in the last week? Anybody? Quick show of hands. Yeah, for sure. How about fireworks? Do you see some fireworks? You hear some fireworks and you're trying to sleep? You get scared by fireworks? Yep, great. The dog hate fireworks? Yeah, for sure. Yeah, it's been a big week, right? I hope you had a time to pause. I hope you had a time to maybe get a little break, maybe spend some time with family and friends. And obviously, as a country, we just celebrated July 4th. July 4th, significant to us because it represents Independence Day as a country. And July 4th, 1776, Second Continental Congress, this is not a history lesson, but the Declaration of Independence said this, that there was a right to the pursuit of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And that's what we're going to talk about today, the pursuit of happiness. Americans love this concept of a pursuit of happiness and maybe self-autonomy and maybe choose what I want and don't get in my way and my rights and sometimes to a point of hyper-individualism that allows me to do whatever I want. A lot of first-person pronouns there, right? My rights, my ways, my life. Now, don't get me wrong. Freedom is a gift. Freedom as a country is a gift. Freedom in Christ is the greatest gift. But freedom needs to be stewarded well and needs to be handled wisely. This passage we're going to look at today is going to point out this, that living for our own happiness is actually a temptation and a trap. And ultimately, if we only live for our own happiness, the Bible would say that's wicked. But living for our God is a path to blessing, to happiness, to life. True happiness or joy comes from a nearness and a surrender to our God, not from seeking only my own pleasure. Being blessed or being happy is not a reward. It's not deserved, but it is a result of a path of life God offers to us, and it is a blessing he wants to give because he is a gracious God. So we're going to, in a moment, turn to Psalm chapter 1, but I want to pray and commit this time to the Lord. Let's all pray together. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for this opportunity, the freedom to come into this place, to gather, to lift high the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, we are not in charge. We are asking, Lord, that you would remind us of your sovereignty, your control, your power. And Lord, thank you that there is a way of life, a way of blessing, and it's found in you. So Lord, would you bring your word to our hearts now? We pray this in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen, amen. All right, here's where we're gonna go. 3 points. The first is this, the way of the blessed. Okay, if you're a note taker, that's your first point, the way of the blessed. Then we're going to get to a second point. It's going to be shorter. Don't be worried, okay? It's the way of the wicked. And then at the end, the third point, choose wisely, okay? The way of the blessed, the way of the wicked, choose wisely. Let's start with this. We're going to look at Psalm chapter 1, the way of the blessed. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers. Okay, now this actually starts with a warning. So blessed, this word blessed, could be translated kind of happy or joyful, that there is a path of life that God offers to us, that there's great joy. That you are blessed if you walk in the way God calls you to walk. But this passage, well, let me highlight one other thing. I don't want any of the women in the room to be upset. You're like, what's up with that? Okay, it's not really male, female. That's not what's really going on. It's really the individual is the way to think about that, okay? So everybody all right, girls? You okay? All right, great. I got a lot of girls in my house, so I got to make sure everybody's happy. All right, so blessed, happy is the man, the one who, here comes the warning, walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers. God says there is a path, there is a way, there is a life where you will experience blessing, where you will be joyful, but you have to be warned of these things. The blessed person doesn't choose these paths, doesn't allow these influences to be primary, to be most loud and most influential in their lives. Some people, when they study this passage, they put a lot of emphasis on the verbs. You know, you see there's a walk, and then there's a stand, and then there's a sit. I think that's interesting. I think the main point really is this. The people who are blessed in God's eyes, who are truly happy, are those who avoid the thinking and behaviors of those who would reject God. That's what it's saying. You're not going to find a path to blessing, joy, happiness if what you embrace is the ways of people who do not love the Lord. But it's challenging, isn't it? Because there's a lot of messaging that comes at us all the time. I want you just to think for a second. Who or what has your ear? Who or what has your attention? Who is a model for you that shows you a way that is not the way of sinners? Who is a counsel for you that is not the counsel of the wicked? It's hugely important that we pay attention, that we're discerning and we're listening and we're saying, does that life line up with what God tells us is the way of life? Does that message actually square with what Scripture says? And if you're not careful, that is a slippery slope. God's people need to be discerning. Have you ever gone to a store and given them does anybody actually use cash anymore? I do sometimes. But like maybe a $20 bill or a $100 bill to pay for something. And what do? Well, they examine it. They look at it. They might have a little marker. They put a mark on it. I'm like, I didn't counterfeit that. What's the deal? But you know what they're doing? They're checking, is this legit? Is this legit or not? Do you know that people who study counterfeit money they don't study the counterfeits. They study the real thing. They're so familiar with what a note of currency looks like that when something comes across their path, they're like, that is not real. That's counterfeit. And I think that's the warning that God's giving us here, that if you are not careful, if we walk in, the blessed one is the one who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, does not stand in the way of sinners, or does not sit in the seat of scoffers. God's people need to be discerning. You know, it's interesting. Jesus actually highlights this too. Matthew chapter 7, verse 13 says this, "Enter by the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the way is easy that leads to destruction, and those who enter by it are many." This is true, right? You could see this. You're like, oh my goodness. There's an awful lot of people who are walking down a path that is easy, it is broad, but it ends so poorly. We're going to see more about that in this passage. "For the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life, and those who find it are few." I love that the Bible's consistent. Here in Psalm, we hear it. Here in Matthew, we hear Jesus saying it. It's the same message. So, blessed is the one, the way of the blessed is one that is discriminating, that is paying attention and saying, is that actually true? Is that actually the way God would say it is and how it ought to be? So I just simply ask you, where are you potentially inviting or embracing the path of this world or the wisdom of this world? Because we have to, just like a counterfeit bill, take it back to the original and say, is that right? That's not for me. That's not the way God would have me think. That's not the way he would have me behave. The way of the blessed is discerning. So very easy to find counsel that will support whatever you want it to support. I mean, it's just, you know, in Christian counseling, they talk about counseling to the flesh. It's like, oh, you feel bad? Oh, well, then you should just change everything. Well, maybe when you feel bad, you should seek the Lord and find help from him and find perspective from him. And I'm telling you, as a believer and as a pastor, we desperately need to seek the counsel of the Lord. You go through difficult times, there's no problem finding a host of counselors who will tell you whatever you want. But that way is broad, and it leads ultimately to destruction. So, let's be discerning. I'm so thankful for my wife. She's a discerning person. And maybe I've told you this story. A couple years ago, we're watching TV with the family. You know, commercial comes on, which is usually when I'm annoyed and muting the TV and going to get a drink or something. But the commercial comes on, and it says this: "You deserve to drive a car that thrills you." And my wife, like, not a half second, said, "I deserve hell apart from Jesus Christ." And I was like, whoa, hun, like, chill out a little bit there. That's a little intense. But, you know, she was like, that's not right. I don't deserve a car that thrills me. In my sin, I deserve punishment. I deserve separation from a holy God. Because of God's grace to me and because of his son, Jesus Christ, he offered me forgiveness. So I trust in him and I belong to him. Don't tell me I deserve all of this. What I have is grace from the Lord and forgiveness. So be careful with the commercials you watch, guys. But media does this, right? Media tells us so many things that are not what the Lord would say. So let's keep going. Verse 2 says this. So avoid all this stuff, the blessed man. But his delight is in the law of the Lord. And on his law he meditates day and night. Okay? To be a blessed person, to have a life of joy and peace in the Lord, happiness, the pursuit of happiness is this, to pursue God himself, to pursue his word, to delight in his law. Now, you need to know, sometimes law in the Bible references the first five books of the Old Testament, the Pentateuch or the Torah, it's called. But really what this means is more than law, it means instruction of the Lord. The all of what God has revealed in Scripture is what we are called to delight in, to meditate on it. The goal would be that God's word is influencing our thinking, our heart attitude, our choices continually. We don't want to just check a box, read a verse, be like, I'm good. I heard a message at church, 167 hours later, I'll come back and hear another one. No, we have to continually be meditating on God's word, delighting in his truth. Question for you, what fills your mind? What fills your mind through the day? What fills your mind through the night when you wake up? What fills your mind in your downtime, in your active time? We think about a lot of stuff, don't we? A lot of stuff goes through our mind. And here's some things that might fill your mind. Maybe these sometimes fill mine. To-do lists. Man, I got a lot to do. Or my calendar is nuts. We've joked as a family with Diane and I have said there's seasons with kids where you're like, we don't make any decisions. We just go places, you know? And so maybe it's that. I'm consumed with to-do lists. I'm consumed with calendars. Maybe it's money. That money, it is consuming to me. I can't believe that bill is due already, and I don't know. Or the other side of money, man, whoa, that account's growing. Hey, I'm going to think some more. I'm going to spend some more time with that money. That money is awesome. Eh? Well, all of a sudden, our thoughts get consumed. Sometimes our thoughts are consumed by burdens, concerns, uncertainties of life, broken relationships, health challenges. Sometimes we're consumed by what's next. You know, what's the next project? What's the next vacation? What's the next whatever that's going to fill that hole for me? Listen, these are all real things, and they're not evil in and of themselves. But because what you think about really matters, but how you think about it is of critical importance. And what we need from the Lord is to continually think about all of those topics, but from a lens of, Lord, who are you? Lord, what do you say? How would you instruct me to think and to prioritize and to live in light of your word, to delight in the law of the Lord? So to be very specific, meditation means this, to fill your mind with God's truth. This is not the idea of meditation where you're like, empty your mind. No. Do not empty your mind. Fill your mind with God's truth. What do you want to tell me, Lord? And then to intentionally review and to go over the words, the concepts of Scripture, and to consider our God and to consider his ways. And then to invite God to direct my thinking and your thoughts and your plans. I love what Isaiah 55, if you're taking notes, write down this reference. Isaiah 55, verse 8 and 9 says this, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." We so desperately need to pursue and understand and live in the truth that God gives to us. And he tells us, blessed is the man who delights in the law of the Lord. That's the path. Now, do you know this book, the Bible, is a treasure? It is. And I just want to take a moment to highlight a couple of verses in the Bible that talk about the Bible, okay? And here's what I believe. The words we're about to hear are the most important words of the day because they're God's words. And so let's just be reminded for a second about some of what the Lord says through his word. That's not going to work. Through his word, about his word. Pastor Jeff makes this look easy, I'll tell you what. All right. This is Joshua 1:8. You might want to jot these references down because when you're done with this, hopefully this message prompts you to be in the word even more this week. You might want to read some of these. Joshua 1:8 says this, "Study this book of instruction continually. Meditate on it day and night so you will be sure to obey everything written in it. Only then will you prosper and succeed in all that you do." Joshua 1:8. Here's Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12 and verse 13. Hebrews 4, 12 and 13. "For the word of God is living and active." Have you ever had that experience? I'm reading the word of God. I'm like, oh my goodness. I have never seen that way. It's alive. It's sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and of spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. The Bible is inspired by God, and when you read it, the Holy Spirit opens your eyes and illuminates and says, this is alive. And no creature is hidden from his sight, but all are naked and exposed to the eyes of him to whom we must give an account. Hebrews 4, 12 and 13. This is the Bible about the Bible, okay? Here's a couple of more. 2 Timothy 3, 16 and 17 says this, all scripture is breathed out by God and profitable various purposes, right? For teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness. How much of scripture is breathed out by God? All of it. What is it good for? All of this. Teaching, reproof, correction, training in righteousness. That the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. See, God doesn't tell you to go on a journey and say, good luck. He says, take this path, I will guide you. The way I will guide you is through my word. Delight in it. Meditate on it. Okay, a couple more. Psalm 119. Sidebar, Psalm 119 has 150 verses. So if you want to memorize a psalm, maybe pick a different one. But 150 verses, but that whole Psalm 119 is really about God's word. Okay? It's really about God's word. Here's what Psalm 119, 105 says. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. That's for somebody here today. I don't know what to do. This seems so dark. Where is the next step? Seek the Lord, read his word, meditate on it, because he will lead you in a path that is blessed. So, and one more, Isaiah 40, verse 8. The grass withers and the flowers fade. I gotta say, on July 7th, this is like peak time for grass and flowers, right? You look around, you're like, wow, wow. Yeah, it's not gonna last. It won't. It'll be brown, they'll be dead, we'll be done with them soon. The grass, as beautiful as it is and healthy, and the flowers fade. But the word of our God stands forever. God's given us this treasure of his word, and we have this opportunity, and he says this, that blessed is the man who doesn't walk and stand and sit in the ways of those who reject God, but blessed is the man who delights in the law of the Lord. He meditates on it day and night. So, question, what's it going to take for us to choose that path, to read his word, to digest it, to ingest it, and let it affect us? I'm going to give you three really, really insightful tips. Ready? Here's the first one. Read it, okay? That's it. That's it, guys. This is the insight we got for you. Read the Bible. I was reading this week about the Bible and about our country. Do you know that statistics say that 85% of American homes have a Bible? The good book. It's nice to have a Bible. I like it right over there on the coffee table. The Bible isn't there because it's good. It's there because it's alive. And it's the path of life for all who will read it. Now, my question simply is, are we reading it? Something I have realized in my life is this. I read it more when I have these things in place. Okay, so just consider this. I read the Bible more when I have a set time. Okay, I would commend to you the first part of your day. The first hour, minutes, whatever you can allot to that. Because, man, your days get crazy, right? And you're like, I'm going to do it at 2 p.m. Yeah, you probably won't. Early in the day, first part of the day, get in God's word. Pick a time, set a time, set a place, okay? Where is it in your house? When I'm really on it, I will get my Bible, I will get my journal, I will get my pen and put it in the place before I go to bed the night before. Because in the morning, that's where I need to be, okay? Pick a time, pick a place, pick a plan. Have you ever had this experience? You're like, you know, it's been a little while since I've read the word. I think I'll just read the Bible today. Let's see. It's a great book. There's a lot of great stuff in it. But I can just tell you, I am more focused in the Word. I am more productive in my time in the Word if I have a plan. There's so many reading plans out there. The Bible app is a great place. There's so many different things. If you don't know what to do, we'll help you. My grandfather used to have a plan. He would read the Proverbs. There's 31 Proverbs, and he would just read the proverb that matched the date on the calendar. That's a plan. Whatever it is, pick a time, pick a place, get a plan. Because then you don't spend your time wondering what I should do. You're like, this is what's next for me, okay? And then the last thing is get a partner. Get a partner. Because accountability helps, right? So I'm going to tell someone what I read, and they're going to tell me what they read. And when I have that in my life, I am so much more focused. So read it. Read it. Guys, this concept of delighting in the law of the Lord, you might be like, I don't know, Dave, that, if I'm honest, I mean, I do read it at times, I do appreciate it, but delight? Okay, here's what I would encourage you with. You got to start with discipline to find delight, okay? You got to just do it. You got to just do it. I've been trying to walk more, super exciting. When you get old like me, what do? I walk. Okay, great. But here's what I'm finding. The more I do it, the more I do it. And now I'm like playing games with myself. Like, can I beat my time on the 2 mile that I did the other day? And, you know, sorry, it's just the pitiful life I live. But the discipline comes first. Discipline comes first. Delight comes after. So read it. Okay, read it. I said I had three. Here's the second one. Memorize God's word. Don't just read it. Memorize it. You're like, you know what? I can't memorize stuff. Yes, you can. Yes, you can. You can sing the songs. We were playing a cookout playlist the other day. These songs are coming on from the 70s and the 80s. I haven't thought about them in 30 years, and I knew all the words. What in the world? We can do this with God's word, okay? Memorize it. I would commend to you a group, a community group, or a discipleship group, because here's what, like our discipleship group, the one I'm in, we have a plan to memorize a scripture every week. What verse are we memorizing? Great. Well, when we meet Friday morning at 6:30, let's say it. That is great accountability. I had a friend I invited into that group, and he was of retirement age, and he said, Dave, I can't memorize scripture. I have tried. I just don't get it. I said, you know what, man? No problem. Are you willing to try? Yes, I'm willing to try. And he did really well. And he told me after about 4 months, he says, I have not memorized this much scripture ever in my life as I have here, because he had a plan, okay? So read God's word, memorize God's word. Why memorize it? Because when you hide God's word in your heart and in your mind, it's accessible. God can call it back to mind. I won't always have my Bible right in front of me and open to the right page, but if I have made it a part of me, keeping it in my mind, keeping it in my heart, the Lord, the Holy Spirit can provoke me with the truth at any point. So read it, meditate, and then, memorize, and then meditate. Meditate. Fill your mind with the truth. All right. Now, this life of blessing, are we sure what the outcome of this is? Do we know where this is going? So I'm supposed to avoid the counsel of the wicked, the ways of the sinners. I'm supposed to prioritize and even delight in God's word, but what will happen if I do? Well, God's word tells us this. The one who does this is like a tree planted by streams of water that yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither. That's a really cool picture of this tree. Can you picture it? Strong, anchored. By the way, is it randomly there? Is it randomly there? Did it just grow wildly? No, it's planted by streams of water. What a great place for a tree, because trees need water. The person who's blessed, the person who's avoiding the foolishness of this world and the wicked counsel that's out there, and the person who's delighting in the law of the Lord, what they will be like is like a tree that's been planted by streams of water. What is it doing? It's yielding fruit, because that's what a fruit tree does. It's doing its job if it's yielding fruit, and fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither. That's a really beautiful image. A tree that is healthy, a tree that is productive, a tree that can withstand storms. That is what the Lord offers us. Okay, can we, where is it? I lost it. Oh, here it is. I got a lot going on, guys. Come on, dude. Yeah, I'm working on it. All right, here we go. We're going to talk in a second about the wicked. For this tree of life, this is the target, okay? Do you know that our church has a mission? Our church's mission is this, you probably know it, to make disciples of Jesus Christ. I hope that's not news to you. If it is news to you, welcome to the mission, okay? Now, we have, as a team, come up with four different aspects that we think really describe a healthy disciple of Jesus Christ. So I'm just going to put them on here. You might want to jot them down. The first one is this, uniquely planted. Remember what we just said? That tree wasn't there randomly. It was planted by streams of water. And we believe that the followers of Jesus Christ were created by God. They were called by God to honor him and to turn by him by faith. And then they are commissioned by God. And you and I are unique. Isn't that cool? There aren't two people in here that are the same. We're uniquely designed and uniquely placed where we are. I live at my house, you live at yours. You have different neighbors than I do. We work at different places. We have different hobbies. Our extended families are different. Guess what? We are uniquely planted where God wants us as he's created us to represent him to a lost world, okay? I'm saying this because this harvest planting imagery is all over Scripture, but I want you to know this is what we're going for as a church. Not only uniquely planted, do you know the second one? Oh, somebody said it, deeply rooted. You're not going to be able to walk with the Lord for the long haul if your roots don't go deep. And deeply rooted means this, I understand his word, I know his word, I run to him in times of trouble. I'm not wondering and wandering and wavering, I'm planted in the truth of our God. An effective disciple of Jesus Christ should be characterized by this. I am uniquely planted exactly where he wants me for his purpose. I am deeply rooted and growing deeper in my knowledge of who he is through the word. You ready for the third one? I don't know if you're ready for this. I don't know if you can read this. Deep, carefully pruned. Carefully pruned. We worship and serve a God who knows what's best, and he wants to see us grow, and he wants to see our lives bear fruit. For that to happen, pruning must take place. That thing, that habit, that relationship is not going to help you walk with Jesus Christ. It's got to get pruned if we're going to bear the fruit he wants us to bear for him. Have you ever got, I had this experience this week, you ever get those like pruning shears in your hands and start walking around the yard? Look out. Man, if I get one of those, like everything's in danger, okay? That's not how God prunes. Carefully, he prunes. Lovingly, he prunes. Specifically, he prunes. Not that. This. That's tough to submit to pruning, that he would want to remove things from me or in me so that I can bear much fruit. But this is what should characterize disciples of Jesus Christ. Uniquely planted, deeply rooted, carefully pruned, and anybody? You're whispering it. Persistently fruitful. I love that. I really love that because my life isn't about me. And my life is sort of inconsequential. But my life means a lot if I will embrace where he's planted me, grow my roots deep, allow him to prune, and then to be persistent in my faith. Lord, I want to follow you for the rest of my life. I want to stay with you the whole way. And as I do that, would you please produce fruit in me, produce fruit through me that would point other people to Jesus Christ and give you alone glory? I want you to see this because this is something our church is going after, and we get it from passages just like this, Psalm 1, that God wants to do this work in you and wants to do this work through you. That was point one. I told you point two is shorter, and I promise it is. Okay, now we're going to talk about point two, the way of the wicked, the way of the wicked. Who are the wicked? Simply put, in Scripture, in this passage, they're all who would reject the God of the Bible as God. And they live for themselves only and deny the existence of a powerful, holy, righteous, saving God. To live only for self-centered exaltation, my agenda or my pleasure, the Lord would say, that's wicked. You're exalting yourself above God, and that is wrong. Now, this is very different. This description is very different than the description of the blessed. Remember that tree? Can you picture that tree planted, growing, fruitful, not withering leaves? Listen to how the wicked are described. Verse 4, the wicked are not so, but they are like chaff that the wind drives away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. Chaff. Do we have any wheat farmers in the house today? Anybody? Maybe Crystal Lake. I don't know. Hey, just kidding. Okay, chaff. Do you know how wheat grows? It grows in stalks, and then you have to cut the stalk, and then you have to grind all of that up. But do you know what chaff is? Chaff is the part that once you have gotten it all ground and you have the seeds and the best part of the wheat, you also have this light, fluffy stuff. And what they used to do is they would kind of shake it like this, throw it up in the air with a light breeze coming by, because they wanted the bad separated from the good. And the chaff, if you did this right and did this with a little breeze, it would just blow away. It's inconsequential. It's temporary. It's not of any value. So we have this description of the way of the blessed described like a tree planted by streams of water. Then we have the way of the wicked, who can seem to us so intimidating and so overwhelming and so strong and so influential. And God's word says the way of the wicked is like chaff. It's going to just blow away with the wind. And those who are wicked, those who exalt themselves above God, will not stand in the day of judgment, and they will not be with the congregation. It's a pretty obvious choice where we choose to go. The path of the blessed, the path of the wicked. And it's a choice everyone needs to make, everyone will make. Which brings us to our third point, choose wisely. Choose wisely, okay? Psalm 1 verse 6 says, "For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish." Man, the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. Let's talk about this word knows for a second. It's not just that he knows the path and how to go there. He knows the person on the path. He sees you. Man, just think about that for a second. We worship and serve a God who sees you. Maybe that's terrifying, and if it is, that's a good day for repentance. But maybe that's just a comfort to somebody today who's like, I don't know. Is God real? Is he near? He sees you. He not only sees you, he loves you. He chose to set his love upon us. He not only loves us, he desires and offers to lead us. This path, this pursuit of happiness is something he wants you to find. And as we do that, he comforts us. He strengthens us. He blesses us. The Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. To be blessed is to be secure, to be clear, to be refined by his grace, to be focused on his purpose, to have peace, to have usefulness, to be fruitful. But the path of the wicked, it will not satisfy. Back in the day, is anybody here? We didn't have any wheat farmers. Do we have any gold miners? Man, you guys are a hard crowd. Okay, so you've seen it in the movies, right, or the TV shows where they go down to the river with their little screen and they take the pile of rocks and they start sifting through and they're looking for that little nugget. If I could just find that little nugget of gold. Imagine you're down at the stream and you got your pan and you're sifting it out and you're like, oh yeah. Gold, right? No. This is called iron pyrite. Do you know what we call it on the street? Fool's gold. It's not worth anything. It looks like gold. You might be fooled to think there's treasure there. It is not. There's no particular value to iron pyrite. This is how the way of the wicked is, guys. where we feel enticed, where we feel tempted, where we feel distracted, recognize that is fool's gold. The way to determine the real thing is to delight in the law of the Lord, to go deeply for yourself. It is not enough that your church loves the Word of God. We need to individually be people who delight in the law of the Lord. Choose wisely. All right, I want to give you a little diagram just to drive this home. We use this in our care ministry, and we call it very cleverly the Y diagram. Why? Because it looks like a Y. Or an alien with no arms and legs. Okay, Y diagram. Okay, who's had this experience? That you're going through life, and all of a sudden, your heart is getting agitated. Maybe it's a point of stress. Maybe it's a point of concern. Maybe it's a point of uncertainty. And we come to this place, a fork in the road. I'm going to put in here DP because it's a decision point. Now, we come to these every day. We come to these dozens of times every day. We come to this decision point. What am I going to do in this situation? What am I going to choose in this scenario? On this path, the entrance is marked with the sign easy. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to hit the snooze button. I'm going to sleep longer. I'm not going to work. I'm going to eat an extra donut. I'm going to make life about me. I'm going to shirk my responsibility. I'm going to, me. Those are easy choices, right? And then there's these choices, which we'll just call them hard or difficult. Do you know, Jesus said this, if anyone would come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. I would describe that as hard. To deny yourself, to say, Lord, I don't live for me, I live for you. But in the moment, maybe it's a point of temptation. Maybe it's a point of, oh man, I got a good comeback to what they just said. The easy thing is let it fly, right? The hard thing is, Proverbs says, he who restrains his lips is wise. Okay, so you got these options, decision point. I'm going this way because it's easy. Well, hang on a second. Because this easy path, you know where it goes? It goes ultimately, I would say, to destruction, or you could say negative consequences. Believe me, that's what I meant to write. Easy now, in time, leads to destruction. It does. If you reject the way of the Lord and say, I just want to do the thing that pleases me, you can do that. It's heading you down a path that's awful, okay? Now, what about this one? I will do the hard thing because I want to honor my God, because I want to obey him. Where is this going? Where's that path going to take me? This path is going to take me to life. This path is going to take me to joy and blessing and a whole lot of other great things. But you have to make the decision here. And I hope maybe this just jogs your thinking for a second to back out and say, what am I doing? How do I keep ending up over here? Well, I think it's back here you should pay more attention. Okay, now, ultimately what this decision is a choice to please me. What would Dave like today? That's usually going to go the wrong direction, okay? This is the choice to say, my life exists to please God. That's it. 2 Corinthians 5:9 says this, we make it our aim to please him. So, we have to make an evaluative moment here. What path are you on? Have you chosen ever to turn away from the path that is fool's gold, that is counterfeit, that is ultimately headed to pain and destruction and judgment? If you have not made that turn today, my goodness, today would be an awesome day to do it. You can turn from your sins and turn by faith to Jesus Christ and say, Lord, I want to be yours. That's the path to life. Now, a lot of us, I know a lot of you, you're like, I have made this decision years ago. I want to follow Christ. Awesome. But you got to keep going, right? We have to persist, be persistently fruitful. The way to that, the way to life in that is to cherish his word, to meditate on the law of the Lord. So evaluate your path. Sometimes the path is hard, though, isn't it? My family, this is summer. Anybody do a road trip recently or soon? Yep. So we do a lot of road trips. We've been a lot of places on the road. Colorado, Texas, North Carolina, Florida, other places. And you know what? My kids would generally tell you those were awesome. We got to go here. We got to go to the beach. We got to go to the mountains. But I got to say, one time a few years ago, I was very surprised. I found a little essay that one of my daughters, her name's Annika, I say with permission, she had written in like middle school about a road trip. And you would have thought her parents had kidnapped her against her will. Because what it said was that she was trapped in a van for hours and hours and hours. And we only had a couple of DVDs, and it wasn't the one she wanted. And we kept passing back food because we wouldn't let them out of the car, but it wasn't the food she wanted. I was like, did we go on the same trip? Because I felt like that was a good trip. Okay, here's the thing, guys. This road of obeying, of honoring God, delighting in Him is at times very hard because we have to deny ourselves and obey Him. And it can get tiresome, and it can get lonely, and it can get discouraging. And I want to remind you, like I would remind my kids, the journey is worth it. We are going somewhere that God has prepared for us. This little bit of time called life is now. And there's going to be some great joy, and there's going to be some great sorrow. But to be blessed, to find the pursuit of happiness, true happiness, blessedness in the Lord, is to delight in Him. And so we make that choice, and we pursue Him for His strength. Let's travel well, loved ones, together on this journey, because it's worth it, because He is worth it. Let's pray together. Lord, we take confidence in who You are and in the truth of Your word. Where would we be, Lord, if it were not for You? And so, Lord, we just ask that You would now sink deeply into our hearts and minds all that is true and all that is from You. Help us, Lord, to not be the ones You describe as just hearers of the word, but doers. And thank You, Lord, that You promise that that is the path to life, to blessing, to joy. We love You, Lord. We need You. Lead us forward. Grow our love for You through our love for Your word. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. Amen.
All right, church, let's stand. Now I count on one thing. The same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Oh yes, I will lift You high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless Your name. Oh yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy. Thank you.
Thank you, Dave. What a good word from the Word. Life in Christ. Liberty, freedom from sin, and the pursuit of true and lasting happiness in the person of Jesus Christ. And then maybe that's not where you are this morning. You're thinking to yourself, you know, that sounds great, and I'd like to be there, but God's got me in some challenging circumstances. We would love to come alongside of you, to pray with you. We'll have leaders up in front afterwards. If you're new, if you're first time, I would love to visit with you, answer any questions that you have. I'll be out in the lobby. Don't forget, as you leave, this weekend only, special opportunity to partner with people who are in need in their back-to-school needs. And as we go this week on our way, on mission for Jesus Christ, know that you are loved.
Dark tried to hide you and steal you away. Death tried to keep you inside of the grave. The enemy fought you, he tried, but he lost. You cannot be stopped. When we cried for freedom, you tore down the walls. The weight of our burdens, you carried it all. Stop.
stop our God. There's nothing that can stop our God. There's nothing that can stop our God. There is nothing. There is nothing.
You cannot be stopped.
There's nothing that can stop
no,
our God.
You cannot be strong.
There's nothing that can stop our God.
You're fighting for us.
There's nothing that can stop our God.
The weight of the world is getting heavier now. Feels like it's far too much to carry around. And each and every little time that you fall starts looking like the end of it all. Somewhere hidden in the noise there's a truth. Someone to believe and hang on to. And each and every little word that you hear, I pray that one thing would be so clear. With all those voices in your head, just don't ever forget that God's still good and he's still got it all in control. Oh, come on and keep on hoping when the days get dark. Keep on singing, don't you ever lose heart. Lift your eyes, the one who gave you life will give you strength to keep on going. So keep on hoping.
Keep on hoping.
What if the miracle's a moment away? What if the morning's just a to break and all the innocence you thought that you lost was there inside of you all along. Come on and keep on hoping when the days get dark. Keep on singing, don't you ever lose heart. Lift your eyes, the one who gave you life will give you strength to keep on going. So keep on hoping. Come on and keep on hoping. You gotta keep on hoping.
Keep on hoping.
Better tomorrow,
there's hope for
joy over sorrow, cause God's still good and he's still got it all in control.
a crash of thunder, like a river tearing toward the sea. Your love is spilling over, flooding every desert part of me. And it feels like I'm coming alive, coming alive. I can't stop, I can't help dancing like I've got no shame. No more fear, no more doubt, never gonna be the same. Eyes on you, won't look back, follow you into the deep. Living like I've been set free. Your love is wild, wild, wild. Your love is wild, wild, wild. Your love is like breathing for the first time. Walking like there's air beneath my feet. Your love takes me high. Your heart is holding mine, and it's never gonna fade. Your love is wild, 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 wild. I can't stop, I can't help dancing like I've got no shame. No more fear, no more doubt, never gonna be the same. Eyes on you, won't look back, follow you into the deep. Living like I've been set free. Your love is wild, wild, wild. Your love.
Broken heart, 'cause I think I'd rather strike a match than curse the dark. Yeah, I'll find a way to thank you, though the bitterness is real and hard. 'Cause I'd rather take a chance on hope than fall apart. I don't think I'm ready to surrender to the dark. Dreams for
it's mine today that Jesus Christ has won. So I can face tomorrow, for tomorrow's in your hands. All I need you will provide, just like you always have.
I can't remember the last time I was content, and now I wonder, how do I get there again? Why am I clutching and grabbing at all the things that I don't have when you've given me everything? Why am I stuck in my feelings thinking I know what I deserve when the answer is clear to me? 'Cause what you give me, Lord, is more than I desire. You're my provider. And when I lose my way, you lead me through the fire. You're my provider. Even on my darkest day, you show me where the light is. You're my provider. And when my strength is gone, I know where to find it. You're my provider. My provider. I'm not forgotten. I you have given has always been enough. Why am I clutching and grabbing at all the things that I don't have when you've given me everything? Why am I stuck in my feelings thinking I know what I deserve when the answer is clear to me? 'Cause what you give me, Lord, is more than I desire. You're my provider. When I lose my way, you lead me through the fire. You're my provider. Even on my darkest day, you show me where the light is. You're my provider. And when my strength is gone, I know where to find it. You're my provider. My provider. You've always been, you will always be. Your faithful hand is holding on to me. You are my provider. Oh God, you are my provider. 'Cause what you give me, Lord, is more than I desire. You're my falls, whatever you want, you